Welcome everyone to our monthly early Friday morning Global Health Security Seminar Series. I'm Rebecca Katz. I direct the Center for Global Health Science and Security, and we are really excited to showcase a collaborative cross-Georgetown project this morning. Students from our research center have teamed up with students from the center who are working at the Center for Latin American Studies to create a white paper series on COVID-19 policy and the impact in the region. Now, our students have been focused heavily on the policy side of COVID-19 and capturing data in our online tool, COVID-AMP, while the students in the Latin American Studies have focused on governance, innovation, and social and cultural inclusion. And they've put their strengths and expertise together to create this really informative series. And this is exactly the type of collaborations that are essential in global health security. If nothing else, the pandemic has taught us that the virus can touch every sector of society, and it requires a multidisciplinary approach to address the challenges. So we are inspired by our students, the ways they've worked together these past months, and feel pretty confident that our future is in good hands. So let me thank our co-hosts, the Georgetown Global Health Initiative, the Center for Latin American Studies, and the Latin American Leadership Program. And we really look forward to this next chapter of collaboration with the Americas Institute alongside with Father Carnes. So without further ado, let me hand it over to John Monahan, who is the Senior Advisor for Global Health to our University President, John DeGioia. So, John?
Thanks, Rebecca. And thanks for including me in today's presentation. This is such an exciting project that you and Father Carnes and the students and the two different programs have been working on together. And so I wanted to just say a couple words about, we have expanded and invested our work in global health. It is a priority of President DeGioia through the leadership of the head of our medical center, through the office of our Office of Global Engagement. We have a quite active global health initiative. We have a strong faculty committee. We work with faculty to bring them together around different research projects, especially working across interdisciplinary work, as Rebecca had suggested. And especially for students who are listening and participating in this program, I would encourage you to check out the Global Health Initiative website. We list events that are going on across all three of our campuses almost every day. There is a student fellows program. So if you're interested in mentored research in this space, this semester we selected 15 students to do research. And I would also encourage you to also look at some of our most successful programs, like the Center for Global Health Science and Security, that's doing really cutting edge work during this time of the pandemic. I would say, you know, the thing that's most exciting to me about today's presentation is that it, in so many ways, it distinguishes what is special about Georgetown. It is a chance to take a very complex issue like the pandemic, the very complicated public policy responses that are required around the world, but putting them in a cultural, political, social context. It's that integration that I think distinguishes Georgetown in so many areas, but I think it's so profound and so real right now in the context of the pandemic. So I'm personally excited to see this series. I can't wait to hear the presentations and to see the papers and see where all this goes. But so let me just say thank you again to Dr. Katz, to Father Carnes, to Allie Reichert for all the work putting this together. And thank you so much. So I think I turn it back to Allie next, if I'm not mistaken. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much, Professor Monahan, Dr. Katz, Father Carnes, for that warm welcome. My name is Allie Reichert, and I'm a research assistant at the Center for Global Health, Science, and Security, and I have the pleasure of working for Dr. Katz. So a little bit about how this project started. Back in September, I stumbled upon this amazing tool called LACOM, which is a map database that was created by the Center for Latin American Studies over the summer to document the ongoing impact of COVID across Latin America. As John was pointing out, from political and cultural perspectives. And at the same time, I was hard at work at our own center working on a tool called COVID-AMP, which, as Dr. Katz talked about, is a global database of policies to address COVID. And I found myself interested in how our AMP database, specifically within Latin America, and the LACOM tool might be able to inform each other and kind of tell that entire policy and context story. And that's what sparked the idea for this project, which came to life with the help of Father Carnes, Dr. Angelo Rivera Santos, and Dr. Katz. So we paired up our center's researchers working on AMP with the CLAS researchers working on LACOM. And then each student pair collaborated, sharing their policy, political, and cultural insights from each side to write a research brief on that specific country. And so we've collected all seven of those briefs into this report, which we are presenting today, presenting our findings from. And so it's now up on our website. And so you can go and read it after the event, and we'll send everyone the link to go and do that. I was lucky enough to work on two of the briefs as well, so I look forward to seeing you all again in a moment. I've deeply enjoyed this project on a personal level, and I'm incredibly proud of all of the work that these students put into this project. So congratulations to all of you. They are truly an incredible team. So I hope you enjoy all of the presentations. And as we go along, please type all the questions that you have in the Q&A box at the bottom. And then Father Carnes will kick it off, and then I will moderate the Q&A session at the end. So again, thank you all and welcome. And without further ado, I will turn it over to our first student researchers, Ari and Valeria, who will be talking about Mexico.
Thanks, Ali. Good morning, everyone. My name is Valeria Villarreal. I am a research assistant for LACOM. I am also originally from Monterrey, Mexico, so this brief is particularly close to my heart. And alongside my co-author, Arian Amanpour, I'll be presenting our brief titled Holidays Prompt the Need for Preemptive COVID-19 Policy. Next slide, please. Before we begin going into the brief, I'd like to give a brief overview of Mexico's handling of the pandemic. We're coming up on the first anniversary of the first confirmed case in Mexico. And since then, we've had 2.2 million positive cases confirmed. And unfortunately, out of those, we've had over 200,000 deaths. This places Mexico at a 9.85% mortality rate. And it also means that Mexico has the fourth highest death toll in the world, even though we only have the 13th most cases. And that also places us at the 53rd place out of 53 countries in Bloomberg's resilience COVID ranking. To understand how we got to this point, I'd like to go into the next slide to analyze Mexico's key policies. The most important one has been the traffic light system. The way this works is that at any point in time, a state is assigned a color between a low risk green and high risk red, according to the number of beds that are occupied within that state. And there are certain social and economic measures that are taken as a response to that color assignment. So to give you an example, a low risk green implies that 30% or less hospital beds in a state are occupied, and all non-essential activities can take place, of course, as long as social distancing is observed. At this point in time, only the state of Chiapas is at a low risk level green. On the other side of the spectrum, we have maximum risk level red, which means that 71% or more hospital beds in a state are occupied and all non-essential business activities are closed. At this point in time, the state of Guanajuato is one of the ones that is in red. These measures have been very reactive rather than preventive, because a state only begins to take action to control the number of cases once its healthcare system has been overrun. And this has a lot of implications considering the November to January period, which we can take a look into in the next slide, please. The November to January period is specifically important to the Mexican population because we celebrate a variety of festivities, starting in early November with the Day of the Dead, and then we go through the Day of the Virgin of Guadalupe, Christmas, New Year's, and finally Epiphany in January the 6th. Throughout this period, people from different households gather under the same roof, often in closed spaces like homes, churches, party venues to celebrate. And we also see record numbers of interstate travel and of tourism from abroad. So in combination with a reactive system, this has created a period of spikes in cases that my co-author Arian is going to go into.
So we began to research the role holidays play in the spread of COVID-19 in Mexico, because when we began our research, we were well into the holiday season and seeing in real time these spikes in cases that were coming right after these holidays. And we reflected on how Thanksgiving in the US was a big driver of household mixing and travel that drove a spike in COVID-19 cases within the United States. This led us to investigate the epidemiology in Mexico, which seemed to correlate with big holidays that began in November with the Day of the Dead and continued into the December and January period. This can be seen in the graph here to the right. Cases began to rise in 2 to 3 weeks after November 1st, which is the first holiday of the season, which is the Day of the Dead. And it seemed to follow the 10 to 14 day incubation period of COVID-19, where we saw this kind of increase in cases 2 to 3 weeks after the holiday. Another spike in cases can be seen 2 to 3 weeks after the Day of the Virgin of Guadalupe in early December, and then the same rise of cases seen 2 to 3 weeks after the Christmas and New Year period. And this comes after a lull in holidays and cases that seem to plateau throughout the August to October period. And we believe that these holidays are serving as super spreader events because individuals are changing their day-to-day social distancing habits. They're taking larger risks by shopping for Christmas and Day of the Dead. There's increased travel for pilgrimage on the Day of the Virgin of Guadalupe. And this is also causing mass gathering and mixing of households as they participate in these holidays. The current policies under the traffic light system, as we stated earlier, are very reactionary, as they do not mitigate outbreaks from starting, rather they pose to slow the spread after hospitals are already being overwhelmed. And a move to new preemptive policies is especially important as the next big holiday season is soon around the corner, beginning in late March and the beginning of April. Next slide, please. And so the reactive policy that is the traffic light system in Mexico has a large economic impact on non-essential businesses, because all non-essential businesses within the state must close once we hit this maximum red light risk level. Business can suffer and shut down, possibly filing bankruptcy and closing for good. These are very harsh realities for a lot of businesses in Mexico. This is because the current policies in place are not doing enough to mitigate the spread of COVID-19 before it becomes a widespread outbreak. And preemptive measures before can take the form of mass gathering restrictions, which are a key driver of transmission, travel restrictions. As of right now, there's the only travel restriction in Mexico is between the land border between the US and Mexico. And additionally, stay-at-home orders can be instituted in the week or days following up to and during the holiday to minimize the spread of COVID-19. This is important because 1 week of the holiday and transmission can lead to an outbreak that causes non-essential business closures for over a month's worth of time. This is currently the case in the state of Quintana Roo, which is a large beach tourism destination well known for the city of Cancun. Non-essential business were focused, were forced to close from January 16th and into February as the state reached a maximum risk level of the traffic light system. This came as the state experienced 16,931 new daily cases, 2,129 deaths on this day. We suggest that preventing mass gathering and travel in the state leading up to and during the holiday can really slow the transmission of COVID-19 and lessen the impact not only on individuals, but also on businesses, because it's more important to slow the spread during the week than to deal with an outbreak for a month or so with closures afterwards. And to kind of bring it all together, this preemptive policy is needed as Semana Santa is around the corner, or Holy Week, which is a very large holiday in Mexico in the majority Catholic country. And in time and time again, in the past, we've seen that this is a large holiday season in which there is increased amounts of tourism to many destinations across Mexico. And the implementation of preemptive policy is necessary to see these cases continue to decrease in the wake of the last holiday period. As the country is currently recovering from its last deadly spike, government leaders should get out in front of the next possible outbreak rather than reacting to the huge surge in cases.
Hi again, everyone. And thank you, Artie and Valeria. That was an incredible presentation. So next up, we'll be talking about Honduras. My co-author, Maria Jose, and I will present our brief called Natural Disasters and Pre-existing Disease Burden Deepen Disparity. Next slide, please. So Honduras has a population of 9.7 million. According to the census, over 40% of those live in poverty and 81% work in the informal sector. So with over 4,000 deaths and over 166,000 cases, Honduras has faced a high disease burden amidst several other ongoing crises, which Maria Jose will explain in further detail. Honduras faces extreme disparities across different regions, as you can see on the map, with 23 physicians per 10,000 in the capital region and only 2 physicians per the same number in areas like Lempiras and Santa Barbara. There has also been a structural lack of investment in public health over the last decade. Next slide, please. In terms of the policy story of Honduras, the first cases arrived in early March, and Honduras was actually already under a state of emergency since February due to an epidemic of dengue and other mosquito-borne diseases. The next wave of policies came on March 16th, when the president suspended business and school activity and implemented a national lockdown. Other measures like direct cash transfers were implemented with assistance from the United Nations Population Fund. Cases then began to spike in July, as you can see, and continued to rise and fall until November 3rd, when the next disaster, Hurricane Eta, hit. And then 2 weeks later, Hurricane Iota. The government then began to issue a series of relief measures, including meal kits, hygiene packages, and other necessities in order to address both the hurricane and COVID-19 at the same time. Cases reached an all-time daily high on February 5th, 2021, with over 1,000 active cases. Next slide. And I'll turn it over to Maria Jose.
Thank you, Alice. A dengue pandemic ravaged Honduras the past 2 years, leaving hundreds of deaths and sickening thousands of people. As the coronavirus pandemic shifted its epicenter towards the Americas, the bifrontal battle became unavoidable in Honduras. Tragically, the public health system had to face the situation with a stunning scarcity of resources, contending against the dengue epidemic, the novel coronavirus pandemic, while also facing chronic government mismanagement and corruption. One example will serve to give an idea about the pervasiveness of these issues. At the initial stage of the pandemic, the Hernandez administration announced that it would quintuple Honduras' medical capacity of response. However, 7 months after buying 7 modular hospitals, only one was inaugurated in San Pedro Sula. But this wasn't the only regular purchase. The buying of masks, ventilators, and medical protective equipment is also under the scrutiny of the Honduran Supreme Audit Institution. Meanwhile, the country registered one of the highest rates of death for COVID-19 in Central America. And at different moments throughout 2020, the healthcare community has been forced to protest due to the lack of proper equipment on the very front lines of the pandemic. Despite immense hardship, the Honduran people have shown solidarity and protested alongside healthcare workers. Next slide, please. Additionally, the 2020 rainy season was particularly active and brutal. Although both hurricanes Eta and Iota quickly downgraded to tropical storms, their consequences were devastating, putting the entire country in a new state of emergency. Evacuations and rescue operations during an ongoing pandemic raised the number of people requiring humanitarian assistance in a country where more than 40% of households were already experiencing poverty. The storm damages further strained the immense public health challenges. More pooling and flooding help anticipate a much greater proliferation of the mosquito. And as you can see in the images, in many areas of the country, homes were swept by the disaster, offering no shelter from COVID-19 exposure. Given the dramatic domestic situation of Honduras and the persistent inequalities across the globe, the history of dengue in the region could serve as a call to reflection, something to bear in mind while we are all witnessing glaring disparities in the timely access and distribution of vaccines against COVID-19. Next slide, please. The idea is simple. Although the history of dengue is long and complex, one chapter of it shows that coordination among affected countries was effective and successful in Latin America. However, the dengue eradication programs were discontinued even though tiny Caribbean islands were still burdened with the disease. As a result, in 2020, no Latin American or Caribbean country was safe from dengue. Coordination and collaboration for timely and equitable access to vaccines against COVID-19 are currently hampered by the hoarding of doses in which developed countries have engaged. wealthy nations have secured more than three times the number of vaccines needed to immunize their entire populations. Honduras, left behind by this regrettable behavior of the international community, has only been able to effectively acquire 5,000 vaccine doses thanks to Israel donation. While the pandemic has shown the vulnerabilities of many countries in different manners, it is also uncovering an inadmissible, unreasonable behavior of the international community that hinders multilateral governance when most needed.
Next up, we have Panama with Julia and Tim.
Hello, everyone. My name is Tim Rudolph-Math, and I'm an undergraduate research assistant at the Center for Global Health Science and Security. Alongside my co-author, Julia Benbenek, who is a research assistant at the Center for Latin American Studies, I will be presenting our brief on Panama's sex-based lockdown policy. Next slide, please. Before we focus in on Panama's sex-based lockdown, I'd like to provide some context by highlighting key features of the country's management and experience of the COVID-19 pandemic. Panama announced its first confirmed case on March 9th, 2020. In the ensuing months, the country of just over 4 million people experienced remarkably high per capita case and death rates compared to other countries in the region. As a result, President Laurentino Cortizo imposed a nationwide lockdown on March 25th, 2020. When the daily confirmed case rate stabilized, the government loosened lockdown restrictions on June 1st, 2020, leading to a surge of new infections. However, the country proceeded with the reopening process, but shifting strategy towards curfews, regional lockdowns, and restricted mobility at provincial borders. Panama reinstituted a total lockdown following the second wave of cases tied to the holiday season. Panama's unique demographic features, its distinct urban-rural divide, remarkably high income inequality, and its vibrant minority and indigenous communities have shaped the country's experience with COVID-19. However, most relevant to our discussion today is the fact that Catholicism is the predominant religion in Panama, with over 85% of the population identifying as Catholic. The country's traditional Catholic values continue to pose significant challenges for Panama's LGBTQ community. While many of Panama's neighbors have legalized same-sex marriage, the Panamanian government is reluctant to follow suit. Similarly, transgender individuals are unable to change their legal gender without first undergoing extensive medical procedures, a policy with severe ramifications when combined with the country's sex-based lockdown. Next slide, please. On March 30th, 2020, Panama's Ministry of Health issued Resolution Number 360, which instituted the sex-based lockdown. Under this policy, women could leave their residences only on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, while men could only leave their residences on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays, each for essential purposes only. The policy further restricted the number of individuals circulating in public by designating time slots based on the last digit of citizens' cedula ID cards. While Resolution 360 specified that the lockdown would be based on biological sex, the government issued instructions to the public using binary gender terminology, men and women. This conflating of biological sex and gender identity left the already vulnerable transgender community in limbo, uncertain as to whether they should circulate on days corresponding to their sex assigned at birth or their gender identity. I will hand it over to Julia for her discussion of the implications of the policy.
The sex-based lockdown has both illuminated and exacerbated the existing gender issues in Panama. Following the implementation of the policy, a number of organizations reported instances of harassment against trans people resulting directly from the policy. In May, the Panamanian Association of Trans People stated it had received over 40 discrimination complaints since the restrictions were implemented. This included issues with entering supermarkets or purchasing medicine. On July 16th, 2020, five government ministries acknowledged these reports of discrimination and denounced transphobia. However, the announcement, which is displayed on the right side of the screen, seemingly provided little relief to the trans community. Hombres Trans Panama continued to report incidents of discrimination, totaling 50 between April 1st and September 14th. reflecting the government's failure to conduct a concerted effort to eliminate prejudice and stigma against trans Panamanians. Next slide, please. Although the sex-based lockdown reduced overall public circulation, the efficacy of the policy has been called into question. The strategy was also adopted briefly in Colombia and Peru. In Colombia, this strategy is reported to have successfully reduced crowds in supermarkets on days designated for male mobility, but did little to reduce them on days designated for female mobility, as women have traditionally been tasked with supplying the household. Conversely, Panama experienced greater mobilization in public spaces, including supermarkets, on days designated for men, which can be observed in the graph. Unlike Peru, which rescinded the policy within 8 days, and Colombia, which followed suit within 1 month, Panama continues to utilize the policy and enforce it again during the holiday season. Now back to Tim to discuss the future of the policy.
As highlighted by Julia, Panama's sex-based lockdown strategy has endangered and alienated the already vulnerable Panamanian transgender community. In order to protect the rights of transgender individuals, the Panamanian government should reconsider the sex-based lockdown, or at the very least, include trans-sensitive provisions, allowing transgender individuals to circulate in public on days corresponding to their gender identity. This should be communicated clearly to law enforcement agents so as to prevent confusion and discrimination. In researching Panama's sex-based lockdown, we hope that policymakers can learn from the case of Panama's unconventional strategy and consider the repercussions of COVID-19 policies on vulnerable communities in their own jurisdictions.
Next up, we'll have a presentation from Maddie on Peru and Colombia. Thanks, Tim and Julia.
Hi, my name's Madeline O'Hara, and I will be presenting. I'm a research assistant at LACOM. Today, I'll be presenting on Peru and Colombia. Andean nations face deepening inequality, economic crises, and migration health emergencies. My co-author, Manya Jane, is unfortunately unable to be with us today. Next slide, please. So it's important to note that Peru and Colombia each have unique political and economic situations, and the grouping together of these two countries is not to discount that. However, there are regional trends, shared experiences, and shared geographies that inspired us to compare them. So prior to the pandemic, both countries were experiencing solid GDP growth with 3.2% for Colombia and 2.1% for Peru in 2019. They're both home to significant indigenous populations and received the largest number of Venezuelan migrants. Additionally, during the pandemic, they've both experienced political instability that compounds the effects of COVID-19, with the impeachment of Vizcarra in Peru and protests against President Duque's reforms in Colombia. Next slide, please. Like many countries worldwide, Peru and Colombia impose strict lockdown orders and stay-at-home policies. Colombia declared a national health emergency and stay-at-home order on March 12th and closed the ports of entry until June 2020. Peru declared a national emergency on March 15th, issuing a nationwide curfew and closed all of its borders. In Peru, these stay-at-home orders meant that many Peruvians who had moved to the cities went home to the countryside, creating a mass exodus on Peru's roads. Connecting to the presentation we just witnessed, Peru and Colombia's cap and Bogota also tried implementing gender-based lockdown policies that were both met with controversy by the trans community and the general public, so ultimately shut down. Next slide, please. In order to combat the economic impact of these national lockdowns, both countries passed significant stimulus packages aimed at protecting both vulnerable families and specific sectors of their economies. However, both Peru and Colombia both have high levels of informality in their economy, making it difficult for many to access this aid. Next slide, please. Lastly, the countries have witnessed an intersectional crisis in which COVID-19 has had disproportionate impacts on indigenous populations, women, and Venezuelan migrants. These shared indigenous communities are especially vulnerable to the virus due to high levels of pre-existing conditions and inadequate access to healthcare. In Peru, only 32% of indigenous communities have access to medical services, with the majority of those medical services being outposts without personnel, or personnel who left in the face of the COVID-19 crisis. Gender-based violence has increased in both countries, especially domestic violence, as women are trapped at home in spaces with their abusers. However, we have seen some innovative solutions to gender-based violence. For example, in Bogota, a network of 630 grocery stores and pharmacies became spaces where women can report this domestic violence. Additionally, the pandemic has worsened the struggles of the migrant community, as the majority of Venezuelan migrants work in the informal sector and are unable to access state aid due to a lack of legal documents. Furthermore, this resulting in unemployment has reduced the amount of remittances being sent back to Venezuela to migrants' families, increasing an already unstable country with additional poverty. Next slide, please. So looking forward, it'll be important to watch for the equitable distribution of a vaccine. In Peru, we've already seen a scandal with Vacunagate, in which political elites, including former President Vizcarra, received the vaccine ahead of schedule. And this caused the former health minister and former foreign minister to both resign as they had received doses. And as both countries face a second wave in early parts of 2021, we'll continue to see how these critical areas discussed in this presentation, the lockdown policies, economic stimulus, and this large intersectional crisis continue to evolve throughout the rest of 2021 as vaccines are distributed. Thank you.
Thanks, Maddie. Great job. Next up, I'll be presenting my brief on Ecuador entitled Indigenous Rights, Gender-Based Violence, and a Crisis in the Streets. So the first case of COVID arrived in Ecuador on February 29th, 2020. So today nearly marks the year anniversary. This patient arrived from Madrid and infected an estimated 177 people in the Guayas and Los Rios provinces. The outbreak in Guayaquil made international headlines for its devastating scenes caused by an overwhelmed health system, with bodies tragically left in the streets and in homes. With a population of 17.3 million, Ecuador has faced a serious death toll from the pandemic, with over 15,547 deaths as of February 23rd. Next slide, please. In terms of the policy story of the COVID response in Ecuador, on March 11th, President Moreno declared a state of emergency. To address the Guayaquil emergency, the military was dispatched on April 4th to close the border of Guayas with the rest of the country and facilitate bringing in extra supplies. The military was also authorized to fill out death certificates, which would then be reviewed later because the health system was so overrun. Interestingly, due to a shortage of ambulances and funeral vehicles, the government authorized the Ministry of Defense to collect private vehicles of a certain size for ambulance and funeral car use. In order to facilitate information management, the government rolled out the SOS COVID app on April 2nd, which showed COVID testing sites, helped trace contacts, and was widely used, but notably did not offer accurate data from indigenous communities, specifically in the Amazon, which we'll talk about later. As some provinces experienced higher disease burdens than others, the traffic light system for a new normal was implemented in early May. This placed power in the provinces to declare their own status, but the federal government had to approve moving in and out of each zone according to case rates and other data. Next slide, please. One of the devastating downstream impacts of the pandemic across the world has been on women and the trans community in the form of domestic and gender-based violence, and Ecuador is no exception. Because COVID case reports use the same 911 line as calls for domestic violence, phone lines have been clogged and reports of violence have actually gone down 33% as compared with this time the previous year. In addition to overrun phone lines because of lockdown policies, as Maddie pointed out, many survivors of violence are now trapped in their homes with their abusers and unable to make calls to report violence. So it's estimated that the actual rates have risen. Some groups, similar to interesting stories that Maddie pointed out, have come up with creative initiatives to help survivors report cases and find help. One group in the Sucumbíos province set up a program to send particular emojis to a WhatsApp group when in danger. And another in Cotopaxi came up with asking for a specific color basket at food pickup locations. So these coded messages would indicate that the person was in danger and triggered an emergency response. Next slide, please. Indigenous groups in Ecuador have faced generations of exploitation, human rights abuses, and structural discrimination, which place them in an extremely vulnerable position to face COVID-19. On the bottom left, Nemonte Nenkimo, who's the president of the Warani of Pastaza, has made international headlines like Time 2020 Most Influential People for her activism against oil extraction. She continues to fight for her community throughout COVID, broadcasting COVID-related information into various Indigenous languages on specific radio frequency and WhatsApp groups, and running fundraising campaigns for essential supplies. As I mentioned earlier, the SOS COVID app was largely missing data from Indigenous groups, so especially in the Amazon. So the Confederation of Indigenous Nationalities of the Ecuadorian Amazon set up its own monitoring system to track cases in the region with an interactive map component and in different languages. Another challenge faced by Indigenous groups is an oil spill that occurred in April 2020 in the Coca and Napo Rivers, the Napo River pictured on the right, which affected food supply for over 105 major Quechua communities, leaving many without food and water access. Food kits and supplies were sent, but it's been reported that only 2 of the food items contained were culturally appropriate, and only 1,000 of the over 9,000 requested packages were actually delivered. Next slide, please. So looking ahead, Ecuador will have a runoff presidential election this April. The second place candidate has been accused of election fraud, which triggered an Indigenous-led march across the country ending in Quito, which is pictured on the left. Amidst the political uncertainty, the country is also beginning to receive doses of the vaccine, which is really exciting. Some have already arrived from Pfizer, and there's a schedule for them to arrive throughout the rest of the year. AstraZeneca and COVAX will also be helping to facilitate vaccine delivery. Learning about Ecuador's policy response, successes, and challenges was extremely interesting and productive, and I look forward to Ecuador's next political chapter and the new policy responses in these areas. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Luca, and I wrote the research brief on Brazil, specifically looking at their stimulus payment plan and the successes and challenges of their targeted approach in terms of employment. Just some background for those who don't know. Brazil is a very populous country, has an estimated population of 211 million. And despite being the 9th largest economy in the world, just ultimately a poor country with huge income inequality problems. Throughout the pandemic, really hasn't been much better. It's been amongst the countries with the most cases, and currently, as today at least, Brazil stands at the second place with the countries with the most COVID-related deaths, with around 250,000 dead. Next slide, please. So to combat the financial complications of COVID-19, things like businesses closing and social distancing policies within the country, the executive branch approved Medida Provisoria 936. Last between the 1st of April until August 31st. And this is a stimulus plan with some other worker protections, but we will focus on what I argue is the most important section of this order, the employment-based stimulus for unemployed and informally employed workers. Just to clarify, in Brazil, informal workers and informal employees are people who don't have a formal contract and aren't registered with the government, in this case being the Ministry of the Economy. This means they don't really receive legal benefits from either their employer or the government. Things like food and transport vouchers, paid leave, vacation, you know, that sort of thing. Informal workers can come in many forms. Everything from street salesmen to work you would normally be contracted, have a formal contract for. Things like construction workers, housekeepers, people who work in nail salons. So it's really a wide range of workers. Under this policy, informal and unemployed workers would receive $115 per month per adult, with an upper limit of 2 instances per family, so a total of $230 about per family. And this is supposed to last from April to August. And this policy was extended to last from September to December, but they reduced the amount of money. They halved it to $57, the equivalent to $57. This policy ended in December 31st, and no new stimulus program has happened since, or been established since, though there are talks of a new one coming up. Can you go next slide, please? So this is important because Brazil is a country with huge disparities. and the unemployed and these informal workers count amongst the most financially vulnerable individuals during a pandemic. Just so you have an idea of the scope of this, 41% of all working Brazilians, which is around 39 million people, are classified under informal employment. As for unemployed workers, that's around 12 million people. This means that 51 million people rely on informal employment or gig type work as their sole means of income. This is more than half the economically active population, or a quarter of the entire population of Brazil that would eventually be eligible for this, that would be and was eligible for this policy. Data coming around the world, including Brazil, it's obvious that people of color, and especially those who are economically disadvantaged, are more prone to infection and death from COVID-19. And informal workers, on the majority, are people of color. Can you go to the next slide, please? So this policy isn't without its successes and failures. One thing that this policy did really well was it used established social programs and accounts in order to distribute the funds. The government took two federal banks that already had these programs set up, and they used them to deliver straight into the accounts of people. Just so you understand, half of the people in Brazil, the entire population, successfully received the benefits of the emergency assistance. And of that number, 59% already were registered in federal social programs. It's also important to note that this policy played a key role in raising the average per capita household income by $33, $34, and significantly contributed to the reduction of extreme poverty and income inequality in the country. But of course, there were a lot of complications, a lot of challenges. For one, there were no protections for informal employment. Contracted workers were given protections in this policy, incentives to prevent them from being fired, but informal employees were not. Just so you get an idea, unemployment increased by 27.6% during this period. And a large chunk of that were informal employees who were released rather than allowed to stay in the work because there were no protections in place. Secondly, the actual value of the stimulus payment that these unemployed and informal workers were paid wasn't actually based on minimum needs or standards of living. This was just a value that was thrown around for political reasons and based on the funds they had available. And lastly, it's the reduced value. This period between September and December, in which they have the amount that people would actually receive. This emergency assistance was the primary source of income for 93% of the poorest Brazilians. And like I said before, successfully increased the quality of life for millions during a time of economic uncertainty. So this payment reduction and the cessation of the benefit after December disproportionately affected the poorest people in the nation, those most vulnerable to exposure and death because of COVID-19. So next slide. Currently, there are talks of a 2021 stimulus program. It hasn't been established yet, but Congress and the executive branch are negotiating. But if there is such a program, it should have protections for informal workers, keep them from being fired and giving them other guarantees. And also the stimulus payment value should be calculated based on actual standards of living, rather than any amount that they could just throw out. Thank you.
Thank you, Luca. Now, last but not least, one of the most beautiful and always exciting places on earth, as you may have guessed, my home. I and my wonderful partner in writing, the undergraduate student and research assistant, Paula Gutierrez, entitled our brief, A National Lockdown, Deepening Economic and Educational Challenges. Next slide, please. While we consider decisive the initial response of the national executive to the novel coronavirus outbreak, we wonder if it could have been implemented in a more aligned way with the federal organization of the country. We then analyze the impact of the measure on Argentina's weakened economy and on in-person education, to conclude with some reflections around the vaccination campaign. Paula will now walk us through some main takeaways from our brief.
Next slide, please. Thank you, Maria Jose, and hello, everybody. Could we go to the next slide? Sorry. Okay. So in our brief, we emphasize the initial national response in Argentina is quick and decisive. As you can see in this graph, the national lockdown was implemented very early on in the outbreak. In fact, there were fewer than 24 confirmed cases in the country at this moment. And while the quick response was initially successful in minimizing the spread, as you can see on the graph, there are low case numbers for quite a while. The all-encompassing lockdown that was in place for many months actually worsened some pre-existing problems in the nation. And as the summer months started, people became restless and fed up with lockdown measures, especially as many people were left without a reliable income source. So people began to go against the restrictions and thus cases spiked. And during these summer months, cases began to shift from the Buenos Aires metropolitan area to other provinces. And the shift really highlighted the existing disparities in health infrastructures, as many of these provinces were not ready for the influx of cases and their health systems bordered on sanitary collapse as a result. Next slide, please. And in examining the implications of Argentina's policy response, we took a look at stay-at-home orders, economic relief measures, and school closures. And Argentina had one of the longest lockdowns recorded in 2020, lasting from March 20th to November 8th. And this response had many socioeconomic implications. The prolonged lockdown measures caused much civil unrest, and the police was given a lot of enforcement power for these restrictions, which resulted in many incidents of police brutality, which further increased the civil unrest. And this lockdown also led to a lot of economic hardships for many people. And in terms of the economic implications of the lockdown, it's important to understand that Argentina was experiencing an economic recession prior to the pandemic. And since the country was in such a vulnerable position, the initial response was really crucial. And so then how did the government justify expanding the lockdown time and time again when it was causing so much harm in the population? Well, President Fernandez has consistently framed his responses prioritizing life above all else. He's been quoted saying, you can recover from a drop in GDP, but you can't recover from death. And this has been Fernandez's justification as he prolonged stay-at-home orders while furthering the economic crisis and social unrest. And the government did, however, provide various economic relief measures. A notable one is the family emergency income, which was a monthly stimulus payment to certain vulnerable groups that was authorized in March and renewed until September. Next slide, please. And so in-person classes were suspended in March at the same time that the national lockdown began. The initial suspension was only meant to last 14 days, but it was extended many times throughout the entire year. And planning for resumption of in-person classes only started in November of 2020, while the resumption itself is occurring now. Some provinces have already gone back to the classrooms, and those who have not yet are set to do so in the coming weeks. And next slide, please. Okay, so Argentina is no longer in a national lockdown, but there is a nationwide distancing phase through the end of February, which will most likely be extended. And in terms of education, as I just mentioned, all schools are expected to resume in-person learning shortly if they have not done so already. The economic relief measures are not currently in effect, but they could possibly be implemented again if the country or certain provinces go back into lockdown and economic activity is halted in a drastic way once again. And so right now, really, one of the most pressing issues is vaccination. The nationwide vaccination campaign began on December 24th with the Sputnik V vaccine, but initial rollout has not been successful. There have been many delays and failed promises contradicting the national government's previous commitment to preserving life above all. In fact, there was a recent scandal when the Minister of Health, who has since resigned, was discovered to be helping his connections jump the line to get vaccinated. So the most pressing issues looking ahead facing Argentina are ensuring not only efficient but equitable vaccine rollout and slowing the current spread of cases and the possibility of reintroducing isolation measures at the risk of further increasing poverty levels and causing further educational harm. And thank you very much.
Thank you all so much. We can, if we could all turn our videos back on, so you can see all of us, wonderful. I believe Father Carnes may have had to leave.
No, I'm still here. I'll jump
in. Still here. Amazing.
So let me just say how really fantastic this is. This has been so exciting to see. I'm so grateful to Allie and Dr. Katz, Dr. Monahan for joining us today. Angela Rivera-Santos of class for really helping pull all these just incredible student researchers together. I think about the work of Valeria and Ari, Maria Jose, Allie, Julia, Tim, Maddie, Luca, and this is just Paula. It's just so fabulous to see the work you've been able to do and to show us something we really emphasize at Georgetown, which is understanding context, understanding diversity. And what we see is this is a common challenge, the coronavirus, but it has played out in incredibly different ways across the region. And we've seen interesting policy experimentation, some with some initial signs of success, and a lot with a lot of shortcomings that we've been able to observe. We've been able to notice the importance of cultural context, the importance of understanding the pace of cultural practices, whether that's holidays or the ramifications of longstanding cultural biases and differences around issues around sex-based lockdown policies, transgender rights and participation. We've seen the longstanding problems in the region of informality and building labor markets, which all people are included in. The challenges of building really equitable democracies where people can participate. And of course, the ongoing challenges of natural disasters, of diseases that were already prevalent, of healthcare systems that were inadequate to this particular situation. So what I love is that you've been able to highlight these pieces in a truly interdisciplinary way. This hasn't been something that just looked from one angle. It's actually drawn on the strengths of both of these programs, the LACOM program, the COVID AMP program, which really have grounded us in a really terrific way. This is something we aspire to at Georgetown. And we're especially excited that now we are launching a new Georgetown Americas Institute, an umbrella which will allow us to better build these relationships between our schools and between our programs. So you have been the early pioneers in that program, and it's really marvelous to see during this time. So what I'd like to do is, I know we don't have a whole lot of time, but I did want to launch us into a tiny bit of questions and maybe ask students and those of you that would like to can respond. But one of the perennial challenges in the region has been democracy that can be truly functional, that can truly represent the interests of people on the ground. And a number of your case studies showed new moments when people have been drawn to the streets to participate, to demand change, to demand action. Do you see signs of hope there? Or do you see signs of continued frustration? What do you hope for as you see that new outburst of community movement, of ground up movement inside the region? And thank you again for these just really marvelous presentations.
Why don't we have one of our LACOM students take that one? Because I know that you guys have been focusing on government and the political aspects as well.
I can take it for Argentina because we analyze the impact of the lockdown on education. And while we were researching, we were able to see how the society thought for the resume of in-person classes, because it was something that the government was trying to avoid, because we understand that there is limitations in terms of the capacity of the health system to respond in case that new surges of cases are simultaneously flooding the country. But we thought that that was amazing because it's a core value of Argentina. We have always been told that it's through education that we are going to improve our lives. And it's through education that we can pull people out of poverty. So we were truly proud of seeing the society of Argentina fought for the resumption of in-person classes. And yes, we see hope there.
Thank you, Maria Jose. There is a question from the audience that asked, what are some of the major upcoming challenges in the region? I want to direct that one to Valeria and Ari. I think you guys did a really good job of kind of setting up a direct next event, talking about Semana Santa and some of the challenges that might repeat themselves. Could you speak a little bit more about that and sort of how you see the challenges that the Mexico will face and your recommendations?
Yeah, I think I can kick this one off and just start. But I think one of the biggest challenges is kind of building off what we've seen. I think a lot of experts new coming into this, including like, say, Dr. Anthony Fauci and even Joe Biden talked a lot to this. And it was the idea that this was going to be a very tough winter season as we entered into, just in, say, in the US, we entered into the Thanksgiving period and that began the holidays. And other countries as well, such as in Mexico, had this long stretch of holidays, one after the other, after the other. And it was important to the, especially in such difficult times, for these people to have these moments of hope. But the government didn't necessarily take on the role it needed to be preemptive and stop more transmission through these policy actions. They waited to handle the outbreaks after. And so now that we see what happens during these holidays and the kind of the cases that go, it's taking that experience and applying it to the policy going forward. So with, say, Semana Santa coming up, it's very important that we utilize the information we just saw from the amount of transmission, the amount of deaths that occurred, to basically get out in front of it and implement stay-at-home orders, implement travel restrictions between states and even international travel restrictions to some degree, and also implementing, what was the third one? But implementing basically these more preemptive policies rather than allowing for 1 week of, say, holiday and travel that results in transmission that closes down non-essential businesses for a month, compared to minimizing the this kind of holiday experience for a week that may hurt businesses in the short term, but allow them to continue without the closures for a month or more of time until they get out of this risk level that's the red light maximum risk.
Yeah, and just to add a little bit to that, I think some of the things that we can look forward to is for civil society to also take the lead within this context, because the government can continue to use a traffic light system, but civil society can also do its part. To give you an example that I thought was really funny, last week was Ash Wednesday, and usually people congregate in huge crowds to get their ash, and my family sent me a picture of them getting their ash in a little plastic bag all the way home so they wouldn't have to go. So I think it's a great time for innovation, for people to be creative, and for them to be willing to sacrifice a bit of fun for the long-term solution.
I love that. That's a great solution to that. So we had a question from the audience asking about what policies Latin America can take to confront the pandemic that will be gender sensitive and support vulnerable groups, especially women and the LGBTQ community. I'm going to open that up to anyone who feels most comfortable answering that, but I, with specific direction toward Julia and Tim, just because your paper really focused on that. So I'll give you guys the mic first, and then if anyone else wants to jump in, then go ahead.
Well, while lockdowns are a critical part of the solution to the pandemic, in our brief, Tim and I discuss alternative policy measures that aren't based on gender. For example, basing lockdowns and mobility restrictions on the last numbers of Cédula ID numbers or addresses. In Ecuador, their lockdowns were based on the person's driver's license numbers. That is one way to establish mobility restrictions while being more sensitive to gender issues and vulnerable groups, as we've seen a lot of women are facing increased domestic violence due to being trapped at home with their abusers.
Just to add on to that, I think there is definitely hope for these vulnerable communities in Latin American countries, especially because of sort of the public support that they receive from NGOs and other LGBT organizations. And organizations like Human Rights Watch. They wrote open letters to the president of Panama, and Panama responded essentially by providing a hotline for people experiencing discrimination based on their sexual identity so that they could obtain public legal services. So that's at least a step in the right direction.
That's great. Thank you both. So we have a question about which it looks like Luca and Maddie have are typing responses to. So I'm going to read the question out, and then Luca, if you could give us an overview of what you said. So what measures can governments in Latin America take to more actively provide culturally sensitive relief to Indigenous communities? And I just want to preface this with a bit that I referenced in my presentation, which is in Ecuador, there's a big critique of government relief packages being sent to Indigenous groups that were full of packaged foods and didn't have anything nutritious in them at all, or were not food that these groups would eat ever. And so while, you know, they sort of check the box as like, we sent this package to this group of people, they're not actually able to be used. And so I think one of the big structural issues is making sure that Indigenous representation is in the government and in the spaces making the decisions, so that when relief comes, there's been this buy-in and this input from the communities themselves to make sure that whatever the government is doing is informed and received well by the communities. So I will turn it over to Luca and then Maddie, if you want to weigh in on that as well.
Yeah, I just kind of highlighted what Brazil did. The major policy that they included was they activated the military to cordon off Indigenous populations as like a social distancing measure, which is not great because it did block them from community support and just living their lives. And anyway, but overall, if I were to, I can only speak for Brazil, but I think we can apply this in Latin America as a whole. Just better healthcare infrastructure, especially in low-income area, high indigenous density areas. But kind of repeating what Ali said, also including indigenous leaders in decision-making committees so that they can show what their communities actually need and what priorities the government should actually focus on for support, because they know best what they need and they know where to allocate the resources that where they're most needed. If that makes sense. Kind of a summary of what I said.
Yeah, thanks, Luca. And Maddie, did you have anything to add?
Yeah, I just wanted to highlight something that Peru has done. Obviously, I think I agree with Luca with like, there's a need for greater medical infrastructure, and some of these solutions are just kind of band-aids, but they're pretty innovative. So the government of Peru partnered with the United Nations Development Program to create Respira Amazonia, a radio initiative about COVID-19 prevention and symptom recognition that was 50 radio micro programs in 10 different indigenous languages. So just as a solution to put out information to indigenous communities in their indigenous language. And then Partners of Health in Peru also developed a mental health chatbot app in partnership with the Ministry of Health. And this app is also translated into Quechua to reach indigenous populations. So it screens individuals and links them to mental health services. So those are some examples of very smaller, more innovative solutions that definitely need to be coupled with like a greater infrastructure and support mechanism.
Wow, that's super interesting. I wanna learn more about that. I wanted to pose, and it looks like we've answered all the questions from the audience, but I have one last question, which is, for our Argentina writers, Maria Jose and Paula. So as a lot of people across the world, and especially in the US, policymakers and teachers and educators and parents and everyone is talking about schools reopening. Could you maybe pull out like one or two lessons from your research in Argentina on sort of their process? I know you focused on the ways that they really stayed home and like kept education at home. Are there things that you think other countries could learn from that experience, either good or bad, as people sort of look to the future of schools reopening?
Yes, I don't know, Paula, if you, okay, you want to take it or, and then I jump in.
You jump in, I go ahead for the education part, I'll add anything.
Okay, yes, we believe that it was a difficult decision, but that the initial lockdown was crucial. But at that moment in the country, the reality of the country was widely different. So we thought that in-person classes could have been maintained, and it was challenging for the government to sort an implementation that is differentiated by regions or by provinces, but that could have been really helpful for Argentina. So we consider that to be a failure, and we hope that the government moving forward would have this into account, because it has been the case in at least the handful of countries that were able to resume activities in the educational field. They have been really following like the reality of the community and trying to protect the community, and not taking this consideration super abstract of a single place, because in Argentina, Buenos Aires is truly important, is the center, is the core in the sense of the country. But sometimes the reality of Buenos Aires is not the reality of other provinces. So we signal that as a failure, but as a success, we are proud that the society was able to make their voice heard and recover in-person classes this year.
And I'll just add to that, that it's like kind of a difficult topic to deal with, it because you want to kind of give them some praise for being so quick and decisive about the lockdown, which was undoubtedly necessary and did a lot of good. But it came to a point where the government kind of was so focused on that education was kind of put aside and not even really talked about whatever the plan was. There was a plan, Seguimos Educando, which came out for how like stay at home education was gonna happen. But people wanted to know what the plan was for going back, especially when cases were not all that high. And so in terms of lessons to other countries, I'd say just kind of being realistic about it shouldn't necessarily be an all or nothing situation, especially when education, it's a very sensitive thing. Many children rely on going to school for kind of their day-to-day needs, whether it's food or just many children were not receiving like any education at all at home. So the lesson would be just, it's not all or nothing, and make sure to be realistic about how long you can kind of put off this addressing this important issue, which, as we said, was not even planning for resumption of in-person classes didn't happen until November. So it was really like tension was building up, like the civil society was very fed up with this, and we think it should have been addressed earlier.
Great, thank you both so much. So with that, we've got 1 minute left. Thank you all so much for coming. Thank you to all of you student researchers. This was just an amazing project to work on, and I'm so proud of all the work that we all got to do together. And I just put in the chat the link to all the papers. So if you want to go and read them, please do. They're up on the CGHSS website as well as CLAS. And we'll be tweeting it out as well. So please go ahead and go read it. Go read them. We'd love to have you engage with them more. Thanks, everyone. Take care.